Good evening. Welcome to California Today. I'm Liang Zhang. Here's a preview of some of today's stories. There was another brazen smash and grab in broad daylight. Robbers looted a jewelry store in a wealthy Southern California city and got away with up to $5 million worth of merchandise. The California State University system will no longer consider standardized tests for its admissions. The school system will now focus on other, yet-to-be-decided factors to select incoming students. And anyone in the real estate market would know prices are higher than ever, while the state grapples with the limited housing that's not stopping some people from buying luxury mansions in Southern California. First up tonight, smash-and-grab robberies have not gone away. A group hit a Beverly Hills jewelry store, making off with up to $5 million of luxury merchandise. NTD's Eileen Ang spoke to the store owner to hear what happened.
Smash-and-grab robbers looted the high-end Beverly Hills jewelry store in broad daylight on Tuesday, according to the police. Thieves made off with anywhere from $3 to $5 million in merchandise. The owner of Luxury Jewels of Beverly Hills, Peter Seji, said he was sitting in his office at the time. He heard what sounded like gunshots and told his employees to get down on the floor.
I waited for what I thought was gunshot sounds to stop. I grabbed my gun. I ran out. I saw my window was broken and they were taken off. A car pulled up, which turned out to be stolen. Four assailants started pounding the window. But we had 12 tempered glass, so it took them like 7, 8, 9 hits of each one of them hitting it to finally break. And then they took off, ran to the back of the alley, and there was another getaway car waiting for them.
The thieves used sledgehammers to smash open the jewelry cases at about 2 p.m. Seji said the thieves knew where to find the high-end jewelry and watches. No one was injured, but they cut themselves while trying to pick out glass shards from the remaining items. They didn't have a security guard.
So now we're just trying to deal with getting new glass and showcases and cleaning up, or floors are all messed up. Moving forward, probably get a security guard.
The Beverly Hills Police Department is investigating the case. Critics have pointed to California's Proposition 47, which changes certain crimes from felonies to misdemeanors, as a culprit for the increase in smash-and-grab robberies in the state.
The governor signed a law that would reduce abortion costs. The law eliminates out-of-pocket costs for abortions. A senator from Southern California first introduced the bill. A pro-life advocate said that some people intend to make California an abortion sanctuary state.
Governor Gavin Newsom signed a new law that eliminates out-of-pocket costs for abortion and abortion-related services. In a statement, he said this would protect and advance reproductive freedom for all and ensure affordable access to abortion services so that out-of-pocket costs don't stand in the way of receiving care. Senator Lina Gonzalez introduced Senate Bill 245, also known as the Abortion Accessibility Act. It prohibits health plans and insurers from requiring copay, deductible, or other costs for women seeking abortion services, including pre-abortion and follow-up services. It also includes removing in-person follow-up visits and ultrasounds for Medi-Cal abortion providers. Pro-life advocates like Seth Gruber told the Epoch Times the new bill is part of a larger strategy and that the council wants to turn California into a sanctuary state for an abortion. California law allows pregnant women to terminate a pregnancy unless the fetus becomes viable, meaning it can survive outside of the uterus, typically around 28 weeks old, or to protect the mother's life or health.
The California State University system is making a major change to its admissions process. Students applying to state universities are no longer required to take standardized tests. NTD Cynthia Kai has all the changes parents and students alike will need to watch out for.
The California State University system will permanently abandon the use of SAT and ACT tests in its admissions process. The policy was first implemented on a temporary basis during the pandemic. And now, the CSU Board of Trustees voted unanimously to scrap the use of the standardized tests on Wednesday. Acting CSU Chancellor Steve Relier said in a statement that the move is in line with the university system's continued efforts to level the playing field and provide greater access to a high-quality college degree for students from all backgrounds. The CSU said the admissions process will evaluate students based on their grades in core subject classes, referred to as A through G courses, among other multifaceted admissions criteria. Those criteria have not yet been specified. Students can still take the SAT or ACT tests if they so choose. Scores can be used to place them into the appropriate level math and English courses. This decision follows the lead of the University of California system, which abandoned the tests in 2020.
The housing market is heating up. Los Angeles became the top seller of homes priced over $10 million in 2021, making it a luxury hotspot for wealthy buyers to compete in bidding wars. NTD's Andrew Thomas reports.
The Los Angeles luxury housing market is booming. 2021 sales in Southern California reached all-time highs. Now, demand is outpacing supply. The region attracts many buyers, who often buy cash and without contingencies.
From 2020 to 2021, there has been a 100% increase in sales volume, which is unheard of. And right now, we are number one in the United States for luxury sales over $10 million. Los Angeles has 27% of that market.
Experts say prices keep increasing and many buyers want to change their living space due to the pandemic and desire the Californian lifestyle.
There are a combination of factors that are causing this. The first being remote work, the mobility. People are able to live wherever they want today. And where do they want to live? In Los Angeles, with the sunshine and the beaches and the mountains.
Trina Vennett is the seller of this property valued at $29 million. For that price, the buyer will get 7.5 acres, as well as an almost 13,000 square foot house with 9 bedrooms and 11 bathrooms.
We've had strong offers on our house, and we've had a bidding war, and it came in over our asking price, which was surprising to us. And I think that happened because people are looking for properties that are unique.
Nancy Mishkin eventually won a bidding war. Her family has bought 9 luxury houses in the Los Angeles area over the last 45 years. She says it's never been like this.
It used to be where you bought a house and they asked a certain amount of money and you put in an offer and then they countered you and then it didn't take long and you agreed on a price. It's different today. Today there's a price on the house, but I'm finding people are paying $500,000 to $750,000 more than the asking price.
Experts say the market is expected to remain strong through the first two quarters of 2022 because of current inflation and interest rates that remain low, though many say they expect the California market to stay competitive for much longer. Andrew Thomas, NTD News.
Despite the luxurious Los Angeles mansion sales, a city in neighboring Orange County is facing issues on the opposite end of the pricing spectrum. And according to a recent report, it's a problem the whole state is facing. NTD's Daniel Hall brings the story home.
Newport Beach failed to move forward with its plan to create a citywide inclusionary housing ordinance on Tuesday. One councilman said the number of units that the state requires to be built is mind-boggling. The inclusionary housing program requires developments to build residential complexes affordable to moderate, low, and very low incomes.
I kind of call this like the California fairy tale. This can all work, you know, when we all intuitively know it can't work. And yet we need to do everything we can to try and make it work. But we, the city of Newport Beach and the residents, get, you know, the wrong side of this deal, unfortunately.
The city's development director said to abide by the Department of Housing and Community Development's requirements, the city would need to add 11,000 units in 8 years.
It's mind-boggling. I don't understand how to comply. And that is obviously bad government when we don't know how to comply with something ourselves. But I don't know how to comply with it if they're going to tell us we're out of compliance.
Newport Beach is not the only place in housing peril. According to a recent study, the whole state is facing a crisis. The Little Hoover Commission, a bipartisan oversight agency, reported to the governor that the state suffers from a lack of focus on affordable homeownership. The study says that since more than 2 million California residents are among those living in poverty, most of these residents spend 50% or more of their income on housing. The study highlights the consequences of high housing costs: overcrowding, longer commutes, difficulty in recruiting employees, and slowed economic growth in cities as more people move out. The report urged state leaders to take action by building more affordable homes in more remote areas, especially as employees are moving further away from job centers and into affordable housing areas in the suburbs. According to the study, the state needs 1.8 million to 3.5 million more homes to house the population and ensure adequate housing for state residents. The need for new housing methods is apparent, as the Newport Beach Council said that even if the entire city was rezoned, it still may not meet current state demands.
Their numbers are not feasible, even upon the rosiest prediction that our consultant has provided, that has not proven to be effective in cities that have tried to implement those kind of numbers. Newport doesn't need to be the test case. We don't need to be the first in this, in my opinion.
The council discussed the matter for over an hour, finally opting to not move forward, deciding that producing so many units is not possible. Daniel Hall, NTD News, California.
It's time for a short break, and here's what we have next. Forensic evidence has led to a possible solution to a 30-year-old cold case. The suspect is already in custody and awaiting extradition to California to face charges. The Department of Justice, along with other federal agencies, announced a case against illegal Chinese money flowing into Southern California. They say a crime ring was operating inside the Bank of America. And a detective is suing the city of Anaheim. She alleges the disputes with the management about overtime led to alterations of criminal evidence in her work. That and more on California Today. After 30 years, authorities say they found and arrested the woman who killed the store owner in San Carlos. Detectives followed various leads, but the case went unsolved for decades. NTD's David Lam reports.
Law enforcement and the mayor of San Mateo held a news conference on Thursday with updates on a tragedy that shocked the community.
Good morning. I'm San Mateo County Sheriff Carlos Bolanos, and I'm here to announce a major development in the 1993 cold case murder of Shun Ming Tang, having occurred in the city of San Carlos. This was a cold case for nearly three decades. Today, I can announce that we've made an arrest, and justice for Mr. Tang's family is at hand.
Detectives went to Oklahoma last week to arrest Raina Elizabeth Hoffman Ramos on March 16th. Police said she shot and killed Tang, the store owner, on April 26, 1993. With the advancement in forensic technology, authorities identified Hoffman Ramos, who lived in San Mateo County at the time of Tong's murder, as a suspect.
The initial investigation yielded possible suspect information of an adult female seen leaving the store shortly after the shooting. Detectives believe the shooting was the result of a robbery gone wrong. Detectives conducted a lengthy investigation following up on various leads. The crime gained national recognition, including a feature on television's America's Most Wanted.
Tong was shot once in the chest while tending his mom-and-pop shop. He later died at a hospital, Trickett said.
Mr. Tang was a husband, a father, and a friend who came to the United States to provide a better life for his family. His death shook the community of San Carlos and has remained a topic of discussion over the years.
It wasn't specified how detectives connected Hoffman Ramos to the murder, but she was a sole suspect.
Today, I would like to express our appreciation to the San Mateo County Sheriff's Office for their tireless efforts to bring closure to this case, and our heartfelt condolences to the Tang family for their loss. Mr. Tang was well known in the San Carlos community as the owner of the Devonshire Little Store, a now 87-year-old small corner store beloved by neighbors.
Trickett said Hoffman Ramos is 61 years old and has a criminal record. She's currently in Washington County Jail awaiting extradition to California to face charges.
Mr. Tang.
David Lam, NTD News, California.
A crime ring running in Southern California has allegedly been illegally transferring money into the United States through China. Federal agencies are now looking to seize the funds. Here's what we know so far.
Last month, the Department of Justice filed a lawsuit in California against hundreds of Chinese nationals for holding illegal U.S. bank accounts. The filing alleges that a criminal ring consisting of corrupt Bank of America employees and California-based agents targeted Chinese nationals to move their funds out of China. The crime ring's business stems from the Chinese regime making it increasingly difficult to move funds out of the country. The criminal ring allowed hundreds of unknown and unverified individuals open access to the U.S. financial system for over 3 years. The U.S. Marshals Service is currently holding the funds. The filing did not list the amount of money. Transfers were made through either currency exchange programs or payments made through foreign countries. According to the report, account brokers would coordinate with corrupt Bank of America employees to circumvent certain requirements for opening an account, like providing proper identification. The brokers used fake addresses while giving employees either illicit payments or clients. Newly issued bank cards would then be mailed abroad to Chinese nationals. The DOJ, State Department, and Department of Homeland Security have begun proceedings to seize the funds.
A Bay Area rapper pleads guilty to conspiracy in a multi-million dollar fraud case. He is among seven co-defendants to enter guilty pleas. According to the Mercury News, rapper Kofani entered a plea agreement with the federal prosecutors. Kofani, also known as Amir Rashad, pleaded guilty this week to four federal offenses: conspiracy, aggravated identity theft, bank fraud, and wire fraud. Prosecutors accused him of committing identity theft that targeted wealthy residents in Beverly Hills and throughout the Bay Area. No sentencing date is set yet. Kofani faces up to 30 years in federal prison for conspiracy alone. A detective in Anaheim is suing the city for alleged harassment. The tension reportedly led to her supervisor altering data in the city's sex offender registry.
A sex crimes detective with the Anaheim Police Department said her supervisor had been harassing her. Local media OC Register reported that the supervisor altered data in the city's sex offender registry, which the detective was in charge of, according to the lawsuit. Detective Laura Lomelli filed the lawsuit against the city on February 28th. Sergeant Jeff Dodd apparently began harassing the detective after she complained about being the only female detective in her unit that missed an opportunity to make overtime on a protest. The conflict between the two led to an alleged alteration in the sex offender database in 2019. The lawsuit alleges that Dodd intentionally entered the database and sabotaged the data, including other occasions where Lomelli's work was deleted. The Sex Crimes Unit is in charge of investigating sexual assaults and rapes. Lomelli is demanding a trial by jury.
Instacart wants to partner with grocery stores to get in on the ultra-fast delivery craze. The on-demand food company announced it wants to cut its fastest delivery option to just 15 minutes. Currently, the fastest on-demand grocery option Instacart offers is 30 minutes. The new service, called Carrot Warehouses, partners with grocery stores to provide a wide range of services, including the 15-minute option. In coming months, Instacart will be testing the concept by partnering with Publix supermarkets in Atlanta and Miami. Instacart sees the new service as a potential competitor to Amazon and Whole Foods' home delivery business. Now to NTD's Thomas Christian for an update on sports.
I'm Thomas Christian, giving you the California Today Sports Roundup.
The NBA playoffs are right around the corner. This is the newest in our California teams. Joel Embiid scored a game-high 30 points and grabbed 10 rebounds, and James Harden added 24, and visiting Philadelphia escaped a test from Los Angeles, which played without LeBron James. James was a late scratch due to left knee soreness, but Dwight Howard helped pick up the slack in his absence. Howard scored scored 24 points, his most in the game since November 2018, and matched Russell Westbrook for the top mark on the team. Tyrese Maxey and Tobias Harris added 21 and 20 points respectively for the 76ers, who won for the fourth time in 5 games. Maxey also dished 7 assists and grabbed 5 rebounds. 76ers 126, Lakers 121. Jordan Poole scored 30 points and dished 9 assists as shorthanded Golden State handed host Miami its second straight loss. Damian Lee, Andrew Wiggins, and Jonathan Kuminga each scored 22 points for the Warriors, who ended a 3-game losing streak. Golden State rested Draymond Green, Klay Thompson, and Otto Porter Jr., and were also without star guard Stephen Curry. Kyle Lowry led the Heat with 26 points and 9 assists. Bam Adebayo added 25 points and 9 rebounds, and Jimmy Butler scored 20 points. Warriors 118, Heat 104. From the half court to the ice rink, we're giving you the latest from the Ducks. Dylan Strome scored the go-ahead goal with 3 minutes and 50 seconds remaining, and Patrick Kane had a goal and 2 assists to lead visiting Chicago past Anaheim. Strome collected his 9th goal in the past 9 games, and he also had an assist. Chicago's Alex DeBrincat, who sealed the win on an empty netter with 1 minute and 3 seconds to go, had 2 points. Taylor Radish also scored, while Kevin Lankinen made 27 saves for the Blackhawks, who snapped a 3-game losing streak. Anaheim's Sam Carrick, playing in his 100th career NHL game, had his first 2-goal contest. John Gibson finished with 24 saves for the Ducks, who saw their losing streak reach 8 games. Blackhawks 4, Ducks 2. The NFL offseason is underway. Aaron Rodgers, Russell Wilson, Deshaun Watson, and now Baker Mayfield, all big names at the game's most important position that looked like they were going to be moved this offseason. Amongst them, the timing seemed right for the San Francisco 49ers to get rid of Jimmy Garoppolo's $27 million per year salary, clearing space for young prospect Trey Lance to take the starting role. The 49ers clearly believe in Lance, as they gave up 2 first-round picks and a 3rd-rounder just to have the chance to acquire him in the draft. But Lance played a limited amount in his first NFL season, only ever touching the ball when Garoppolo was out with an injury. The 49ers reportedly have a high asking price for any team that wants to make a move for Garoppolo. The problem is the former second-round pick would not be worth the speculated price of 2 second-rounders, especially if the 49ers will have to release him shortly if they want to make Lance the starter and not pay the rest of Garoppolo's contract. Garoppolo led the 49ers this season to the NFC Championship game, and in 2020 brought the 49ers all the way to the Super Bowl. He ranked 12th this season in QB passing yards.
As always, I'm Thomas Christian, and thanks for tuning in.
And that's all for tonight. You can join us again on California Today every weekday at 8:30 p.m. If you have any news tips or ideas for our show, or just want to let us know how we're doing, our email is california.today@ntd.com. I'm Ling Zhang. We'll see you next time.